Sure. Okay, you gonna tell me when to start this? Okay. Praise the Lord, everybody. Good morning. Good morning or good afternoon. So great to gather for worship today, whether you are here on location or online. If you're online, hit some hearts, hit some likes, right? If you are here on location, why don't you celebrate the Lord with me today? It's okay to clap. It's okay to celebrate Jesus. Come on. Hallelujah. Amen. Amen. Such a great opportunity, y'all, for us to gather for worship today. And as we prepare our hearts and minds for the word and to worship together today, I am delighted that you chose Faith Community Bible Church as your place of worship today. Right here at Faith Community, we exist simply to make Christ known in the community by caring for the community. And I'm so thankful to the Lord for everything that he's doing in our life. And as we prepare for worship, grab your Bibles real quick and go to Titus chapter 2 with me. Titus chapter 2. Titus chapter 2 is where we'll be today. Titus chapter 2. I will read verses 1 through 10. Titus chapter 2. Verses 1 through 10. There's a word, you guys, from the Lord, and it reads this way. But as for you, teach what accords with sound doctrine. Older men are to be sober-minded, dignified, self-controlled, sound in faith, in love, and in steadfastness. Older women likewise ought to be reverent in behavior, not slanderers or slaves to much wine. They are to teach what is good, and so train the younger women to love their husbands and children, to be self-controlled, pure, working at home, kind, and submissive to their own husbands. Watch this, that the word of God may not be reviled. Likewise, urge the younger men to be self-controlled. Show yourself in all respects to be a model of good works. And in your teaching, show integrity, dignity, and sound speech that cannot be condemned, so that an opponent may be put to shame, having nothing evil to say about us. Bondservants ought to be submissive to their own masters in everything. They ought to be well-pleasing, not argumentative, not pilfering, but showing all good faith, so that in everything they may adorn the doctrine of God our Savior. Titus chapter 2, verses 1 through 10. Bow your heads with me as we prepare to go to the throne of grace and continue in our worship. Father, in the name of Jesus, we honor you. We adore you, Father. Hallelujah. We make you big, Lord. You and you alone are worthy of all the glory, all the honor, and all the praise, Father. We scream your name, Father, because better, Lord, is one day in your courts, Lord, than thousands elsewhere. Father, we know that there's power in your name. There's healing in your name. There's deliverance in your name. Hallelujah. There's salvation in your name. There's peace in your name. There's joy in your name. And Father, we are gathering today to worship, Lord, to worship none other but you, Lord, because you are worthy. So I pray, God, that as we lift our hands, as we lift our voice, Father, as we hear your word, God, that our lives will be changed, that our hearts will be chiseled. But Father, we pray today that you will be glorified. Father, you're in control. Father, you are worthy. You are perfect and you are just. Receive us as we worship you today. We love you, Lord, and we thank you for hearing our prayer. It's in Jesus' name we pray and ask it all. Amen. If you're home or if you're here, why don't you stand with us as we go further in our worship today. Let's celebrate God together this morning as we worship together.
You are excellent. Lord, you are mighty. God, you are fantastic. God, you are everything to me. God, I give you my heart. I give you my soul. I give you my mind, God. For there's no greater love than what you've shown to me, God, that you love me so much you sent your son to die for my sins. So, God, we thank you. God, we come to you humbly, Lord. God, we come to you broken. God, we come to you with a broken spirit and a contrite heart. Lord, we just pray that you take rest, Lord. Take rest, God. We love you. Be with us, God, as we move forward in this service. Amen. There's a song that just talks about the great love of God. The great love of God, that God is so great. He's so amazing. So I want you all to do me a favor wherever you are. If you are at home, in your living room, wherever you are, stand to your feet. And we just gonna give God some praise. Amen. All those who are in here with me, stand to your feet. Now I'm gonna ask you to do something else. Can you all just clap your hands like this for me? You'll never abandon your love. We will never know how much it cost to see our sins upon that cross. My pastor, my previous pastor, Pastor Lawrence Baker, used to have a saying, did it cost more than it was worth, or was it worth more than it cost? God, I'm so grateful for you dying on the cross for me. Lord, let me live my life in a way that's pleasing to you. Let me live my life in a way that glory and honors you, God. That's a new word, honify. It glorifies and it honors him at the same time. But God, we're just so grateful for your love. So we invite you into our hearts, so that the things that we say and the things that we do is all ordered by you. We're just gonna sing some older songs. The song just says,
welcome into this place.
I lift you up and I have a relationship with the Heavenly Father, when you understand what Christ did for us and how He loves us, the Bible says we are the bride of Christ. And I'm so grateful to be connected with Christ and that He loves me as His bride. He gave for me. He sacrificed for me. So it's with honor, it's with pleasure that I sing and tell Him just how much I love Him. Can you all, wherever you are, just say, Lord, I love you. God, I love you. I don't know how it is if you've ever been in love like this. Pastor, I don't know if anybody ever been in love like this. So where the first thing you do when you wake up in the morning is just think about, Lord, what can I do to serve you on today? Lord, how can I praise you on today? Lord, how can I make you smile on today? That's true intimacy with the Lord. That's true intimacy with the Lord. So I just ask you, search your heart as we continue to sing. The song just says, I love you, Jesus. Thank you, Lord. I worship and adore you. Just want to tell you, Lord, I love you. I love you, Lord.
Offer up this prayer.
Today. Come on, don't kid me. I wonder if you really are excited about Jesus and if you really came to worship him. I'm talking about, like, in spite of your feelings, in spite of your circumstances, are you here to worship God? If you're here to worship God, just lift your hands where you are and begin to cry out to Jesus today. I want to tell you that the only second promise to you is the one that just passed. So in this moment, I dare you to lift your hands and worship God. I dare you right now to call out his name. I dare you to not allow your neighbor to distract you. I dare you to not be embarrassed to call on the name Jesus. Lord, we worship you. Hallelujah. We honor you. We magnify you, God. We make you big. Hallelujah. Father, you're wonderful. You're holy. You're perfect. Our life is not our own, God. It belongs to you. So, Father, we worship you. Hallelujah. I dare you to worship him. I want to tell you, worship is not a spectator sport, but it's something that we all can participate in. Let me tell you, this is the offering period. No, we ain't passing buckets. We lifting our hands. This is offering. Hallelujah. We bless you, God. Think about it. So we lift our hands. So we lift our hearts as we offer up this praise to your name. So we lift our hands as we lift our hearts as we offer up this praise to your name. So we lift our hands as we lift our hearts as we offer up this praise unto your name. Come on, let's worship God together. Let's worship. As we lift our hands, as we lift our hearts, as we offer up this praise unto your name. Come on, if you want to worship, worship, worship. As we lift our hands, as we lift our hearts, as we offer up this praise unto your name. other name. Hallelujah. As we lift our hearts, as we offer up, yeah, yes, as we offer up, Lord, this praise unto your name. One more time, as we offer. As we offer up this praise unto your name. Father, we magnify you. Father, I pray that we won't be so dignified that we won't worship. I beg you today that we won't be embarrassed to give you honor. I pray that we won't be embarrassed to give you praise. I don't care, Lord, who's standing next to us. I don't care who's listening, God. I don't care. No matter what this world is doing, God, let us give you honor. Let us give you glory. Let us give you praise. Let us lift your name. Hallelujah. Hallelujah. All that we have is yours, God. You be glorified. Father, you be lifted high. We just want you to be glorified. Receive our worship today, Lord. Father, you're magnificent. All that we are, all that we will ever be, we want to give you glory with it. Thank you, Jesus, for hearing our prayer and receiving our worship this morning. It's in your name, Father, that we pray and ask it all. Amen. Father, you are great. You can be seated if you can. But the Lord is so good. He's so gracious. He's so kind to us. And it's our privilege to lift our hands. It's a privilege to lift our voice. It's a privilege to honor our Father. And I don't ever want to be the guy that gathers, even if it is virtually, and too cool to lift my hands. I don't ever, Pastor Andrew, want to be too cool that I don't scream his name. I don't ever want to be in a position or an opportunity for the Lord's presence to sweep through and I not invite him in. So God be glorified. I want to take advantage, you guys, of this moment to welcome each of you here to Faith Community Bible Church, where we exist simply to make Christ known in the community by caring for the community. And I am really just in awe of what the Lord is doing here within Faith Community and in the surrounding areas, that the Lord still has his hands on us. And my prayer continually is that his anointing will fall fresh on us, that we will continually see the Lord breathe on us, that he will speak to us, but that him speaking to us, that we will continually also speak to him. My prayer, y'all, is that we will be a church of prayer or the Lord will dissolve us. That may not be y'all prayer, but that is mine. I do not want to be a part of a church that don't talk to God. I don't want to be a part of a church that the Lord don't speak to. So we must, y'all, honor our moments. Every second that we have to talk to the Lord, we ought to take advantage of it. And I am delighted today to lead you guys in that. I'm thankful for all of our leaders who are here on location, first time back all together since March. So we're celebrating God today for the leaders of Faith Community Bible Church. If you're watching online, yeah, we social distancing. Folks got masks on. We got hand sanitizer all over the place. but our leaders are worshiping together. We are praying with you. We're praying for you. And we are eagerly anticipating a time where you will be here to worship with us. There's so much happening around us, y'all. Even though we are not meeting, the Lord is making things happen in Faith Community Bible Church. And we are all grateful to be a part of the Lord's redemptive plan. Y'all, we are in a preaching series, y'all, now called Standard, which we are walking through Paul's letter to Titus. Y'all, thankful for Pastor Brandon for preaching last week, and we're glad to be back today. So grab your Bibles and go with me. Go with me to Titus chapter 2. Titus chapter 2 is where we are. Titus chapter 2. And I will read verses 1 through 10. Titus chapter 1, verses 1 through 10. When you have it, why don't you stand to your feet as we read together? If you're here on location or if you are at home, I'm asking in this moment that we begin to show honor and reverence to the word of the Lord by standing for the reading of the word. Titus chapter 2, verses 1 through 10. Titus 2, 1 through 10. There's a word from the Lord, and it reads this way. But as for you, teach what accords with sound doctrine. Older men are to be sober-minded, dignified, self-controlled, sound in the faith, in love, and in steadfastness. Older women, likewise, are to be reverent in behavior, not slanderers or slaves to much wine. They are to teach what is good. And so train younger women to love their husbands and children, to be self-controlled, pure, working at home, kind and submissive to their own husbands, that the word of God may not be reviled. Likewise, urge the younger men to be self-controlled. Show yourself in all respects to be a model of good works, and in your teaching show integrity, dignity, and sound speech that cannot be condemned, so that an opponent may be put to shame, having nothing evil to say about us. Bond servants are to be submissive to their own masters in everything. They are to be well pleased, not argumentative, not pilfering, but showing all good faith, so that in everything they may adorn the doctrine of God our Savior. That's Titus 2, verses 1 through 10. Bow your heads and let's pray together. Father, you are wonderful. And today, we are thankful that we have the privilege to be in relationship with you. And as we listen to your word today, God, I pray that our ears will be unplugged. Father, that our hearts will be softened. I'm asking today, God, that you will speak to us through the scriptures. Lord, that your voice will be clear. I pray today for all of my brothers and sisters that as they hear your word, Lord, that they won't be quick to think about other folks, Lord, but they will see how the word applies to their life. I beg you today that you let the words of my mouth and the meditations of my heart be acceptable in your sight. That as I preach today, that I may preach with clarity, with power, and conviction. That your voice will be louder than mine, but that I will preach, Lord, what I've experienced and not what I read. Thank you, Father, for this moment. It's in Jesus' name we pray. Amen. Amen. You may be seated. Just for a couple minutes, guys, in our series titled Standard through Paul's letter to Titus, I want to preach, if I can, from a subject. It has everything to do with you. It has everything to do with you. I know that, y'all, we live in a time and a culture where we wrap our minds around this idea that I'm just going to mind my own business, that I'm just going to stay in my lane, right? That that I ain't going to get involved in different situations that other folk got to do with in the church. I'm just going to mind my own business. I'm gonna share Kermit the Frog memes that say sipping my tea. It ain't got nothing to do with me and all that other stuff. But I want to tell you today that it has everything to do with you. So much so, Sister Georgette, that we cannot ignore the fact that church hurt is real. Church hurt is real, and many of us have in one way or another experienced it. Blaming the church for many of the pains that we experience because we've experienced the pain of being a part of the church that we tend to forget that we are the church. It's interesting, Adria, how we tend to wrap our minds around church hurt, but fail to forget that the same church that we cause pain in or that pained us, we are a part of. Blaming the church for many of the pains that we experience without taking responsibility for our part in it. Has it ever occurred to you, family, that while you've experienced hurt from the church, that you could possibly be a part of the problem too? Maybe it wasn't you that did it, but maybe you let it happen and you ain't say nothing. Maybe you witnessed it, but instead of you living out Matthew 18, that you instead had a party at your house and talked about it amongst your friends. Maybe it wasn't you that slept with somebody else in the church, but you talked about it when the evidence was there that it was happening. Maybe you didn't kill him with a knife, but maybe you killed him with your words. It's interesting how we've become a culture that calls adultery sin, homosexuality sin, and all that other stuff, but we downplay gossip. Church hurt. It's real. Church hurt is real, and it's very painful. So much so that we all have become a part of the problem and not a part of the solution, because we fail to own our responsibility in it, thinking that it does not have anything to do with us. But I want to implore you today, genuinely converted, blood-bought believer, that it has everything to do with you. Lawyer-turned-pastor Carrie Newhoff wrote a blog a few years back titled, Five Things People Blame the Church For, But They Shouldn't. Again, the title of this blog, Brother Durrell, was Five Things People Blame the Church For That They Shouldn't. Five things that the church blame the church for that ain't the church's fault. The five things that he shares is that the church did not stop you from growing spiritually. The church did not burn you out. The church did not make you cynical. The church did not cause your unforgiveness. And the church did not make you lose your faith. In this blog, he begins to talk about how people don't own their things, but they're quick to blame other folk. Do you know that if you're not growing spiritually, it's not the church's fault, it's your fault. Just like if you're hungry and you ain't had a meal, you starving because it's you. Well, it's funny that we pick and choose. We hungry, but we don't want a bologna sandwich. Well, if that's all you got and you don't want to eat it, then you ain't hungry. We blame the church for burning us out instead of owning the fact that we don't have the discipline to say no. We blame the church for making us cynical. Blame the church, Brother Anderson, for that we are walking around unforgiveness, that we are walking around with bitterness in our heart instead of owning the fact that we just need to address the brokenness in our own heart. We are blaming the church for losing our faith, but we was the ones that didn't go to Bible study and never showed up for worship. We blaming the church when we ain't the ones that plugged in since this pandemic started. I want to tell you that it has everything to do with you. Many times, y'all, we blame the church for things that are very much our issue, acting like it has nothing to do with us, but y'all, that is far from the truth. It has everything to do with us, and each and every last one of us, here it is, must begin to take responsibility not only for the church, but also the conditions within it. I've said it before, y'all, over the last couple of weeks, and I want to say it again. The American church is unhealthy because the American Christian is unhealthy. The church is unhealthy because those within it are unhealthy. It's difficult to get your unbelieving family and friends to come to church with you when you always tell them that you don't want to go. It's difficult to get your unhealthy friends to want to come and be healthy at a church that you ain't showing health in. The church is unhealthy because those within it are unhealthy. Since it has everything to do with us, listen, we must own our responsibility in the church. Know today, family, that each of us play an important role in the church becoming healthy. That's the main point today. That's what I want to scream a little bit today, Sister Nikki, if I can, right? Each of us play an important role in the health of the church. And listen, we have to stop ignoring it. I'm willing to bet if you unhealthy at home, you unhealthy at church. I'm willing to bet that if your marriage is unhealthy, your relationship with the Lord is unhealthy. I'm willing to bet that if you're an unhealthy parent to your children, you're an unhealthy child to your spiritual father as well. The church is unhealthy because the people that fill it is unhealthy. Each of us play an important role in the health of the church. Well, why? Why do each of us play an important role in the church? Let me help you understand this. You play an important role in the church simply because, here it is, we make up the church. You play an important role in the church simply because we are the church. The church is not a building, but a body of believers with a specific nature and a specific purpose. As the church, here it is, we gather to grow in gospel grace, then we scatter to apply gospel balm to our broken world. That helps us to understand, Sister Tracy, why our world is so broken is because as the church, we are not applying gospel truth to the world. We would just much rather apply LeBron is better than Kobe. We would much rather apply the Chiefs are better than the Cowboy. We would much rather apply, right, what's better than what? No. If we want to see healing, gospel healing, affect our world, if the world is being the world, then the church got to start being the church. There's no need for me to continue to argue about the decisions of this world, but I would much rather stand on my responsibility as a genuinely converted, blood-bought believer and be the church. Because I'm going to tell you, Deacon Willis, see, listen. Instead of the church setting the temperature for the world has began to set the temperature for the church, because we've bought into this whole idea that if we want to win them, we have to look like them. But let me tell you this, if you look them like them, I ain't talking about your dress, I'm talking about your behavior. If your behavior is like theirs, how will they know that the gospel actually works for you? Church is not a building, but it's a body of believers with a specific nature and a specific purpose. Yes, there are times when the church faces challenges and struggles to one degree or another. But listen, a healthy church seeks to overcome those challenges in a way that honors God and the intentions that he has for his church. Do you know that as the church, you are the bride of Christ and your husband want what's best for you? When you belong to Jesus, when you are the church, you are the bride of Christ, and he wants what's best for you. Let me tell you, it has everything to do with you. And each of us play an important role in the health of the church. And as we look here at Titus 2, y'all, Paul tells us how. Paul tells us how. See, ending chapter 1, remember, Paul talked about unhealthy leaders. He talked about counterfeit teachers, right? Y'all remember, he talked to us, right? We talked about this 2 weeks ago. He talked to us, right, about how to recognize counterfeits. He told us who they are and how we should respond to them, right? Y'all remember Titus chapter 1, verse 10 through 16, for there are many rebellious people full of empty talk, deception, especially those from the circumcision party. Y'all notice, right? He says, for there are many rebellious people, full of empty talk and deception, especially those from the Republican Party. For there are many rebellious people, full of empty talk and deception, especially those from the Democratic Party. Right? Right? Well, what am I saying? We find ourselves becoming rebellious people, full of empty talk and deception, because we're aligning ourselves with parties that's not Jesus's party. We're aligning ourselves with things that our Savior would never align himself to, and we wonder why the church is full of counterfeit Christians. It's because, right, instead of aligning ourselves with the author and the finisher of our faith, we want to align ourselves with people who are going to give us a star on the Hollywood Walk of Fame. For there are many rebellious people, full of empty talk and deception, especially those from the circumcision party. It is necessary to silence them. They are ruining entire households by teaching what they shouldn't in order to get money dishonestly. One of their very own prophets said, Cretans are always liars, evil beasts, lazy gluttons. This testimony is true. For this reason, he says, rebuke them sharply so that they may be sound in the faith and may not pay attention to Jewish myths and the commands of people who reject the truth. To the pure, everything is pure. But to those who are defiled and unbelieving, nothing is pure. In fact, both their mind and their conscience are defiled. They claim to know God, but they deny him by their works. They are detestable, disobedient, and unfit for any good work. Yes, y'all, we must know who they are and how to respond to counterfeits, but we cannot. Here it is. Yeah, we must know who counterfeits are. Yes, we must respond to them, but here it is. We cannot allow the dialogue with them to take up all of our time either. If we spent every second of every moment arguing and debating with counterfeits, then what will we do about those who should be growing in the faith? If we're spending all of our time becoming apologists, what happens when the church isn't being discipled? If we spend all of our time arguing about whether folks is Reformed or Arminian, spending all of our time arguing the hypostatic union, spending all of our time arguing eschatology, talking about ecclesiology, yeah, some of y'all are like, what's that? Exactly. We don't spend enough time talking about Jesus. We spend time talking all of this other stuff, but we're not discipling people. Yeah. Yeah, we know that we should respond and know who they are. But if we spend all of our time, y'all, pointing out the unhealthiness of the church, what should we do? How will we know what to do to make the church healthy? Remember, I told you already, the church is unhealthy because the Christian is unhealthy. Paul shows us in the text. He shows us in the text, there's one important role that each of us have to play in the health of the church, knowing that the health of the church has everything to do with us. There's one responsibility that Paul shows us here in the text that we must own. Y'all, I wish Mama Tisha was here because I just got one point today. I just got one preaching point. She said to me, I know how long your sermons are based off your points. Well, I'm about to mess up your theory because I got one point and I'm taking all my preaching time. Here it is, right? Paul shows us here one responsibility. He shows us one responsibility here in this text that we must own. Point number one, and the only point, we must, here it is, proclaim things that are consistent with sound teaching. He says it. Proclaim things that are consistent with sound teaching. There's one important role, y'all, that each of us, the church, has to play in the health of the church. Knowing that the health of the church has everything to do with us, there's one responsibility that Paul shows us here in our text that we must own. And that focus, that point, y'all, listen, is to proclaim things that are consistent with sound teaching. Look at verse 1 in the text. Look at verse 1. Titus 2:1. But as for you, teach what accords with sound doctrine. But you are to proclaim things consistent with sound teaching. When he says you, he wasn't just talking about some random dude on the block. He wasn't just talking about some random person at your dinner table who you invited. No, he said, but you are. He was talking about you. You. When he says you, he was talking about you, right? I wish that you would just pick up your mirror, your word, and look at it, and you would begin to see your own face. You would begin to see your own scars. You would begin to see your own issues and know that he was talking to you. Who? All of us are responsible. Here it is, to proclaim things consistent with sound teaching. Now this tells us. This tells us, Judah, here, this tells us why the church is in the state that it's in. See, because for some reason, y'all, we thought it was only up to the pastor to proclaim things consistent with sound teaching. We thought that it was only the responsibility of those who preach week after week or the job or the leadership. But all of us, let me tell you, are responsible for proclaiming things consistent with sound teaching. Pastor Byrd, you're going to have to prove it to me because I don't want to believe that. Pastor, you're going to have to help me to see that because I just don't want to believe it. Good. I feel like preaching anyhow. Come here. Ephesians 4:25. Therefore, putting away lying, speak the truth, each one to his neighbor, because we are members of one another. He says, be angry. Do not sin. Don't let the sun go down on your anger. And don't give the devil any opportunity. Let the thief no longer steal. Instead, he is to do honest work with his hands, so that he has something to share with anyone in need. No foul language should come from your mouth, but only what is good for building up someone in need, so that it gives grace to those who hear. We must, family, embrace our responsibility as the church to proclaim things that are consistent with sound teaching. Listen to this, y'all. As Paul uses this word proclaim, it simply means, here it is, to speak out, to utter, to teach, to preach, y'all. This verb is also translated as a noun phrase, meaning your speech or what you say. This verb here, right, proclaim, indicates oral teaching or even informal conversation. What am I saying? What am I asking? What are you proclaiming? What conversations are you having? What are you speaking, right? What words are coming from your mouth? Think about Chris Tucker in the movie Rush Hour. When he was having a conversation with Carter, right? Y'all remember, do you understand the words that are coming out of my mouth? 9 times out of 10, people don't understand it because you're too busy talking about them. I mean, you're too busy talking about you instead of talking about him. If we are to proclaim things that are consistent with sound teaching, then we must proclaim him. We must proclaim this age-old story that talks about a man who took our sin on his back. This age-old story about how Jesus is 100% man, 100% God, who gave his life on the cross as a ransom for many. We must proclaim what is consistent with sound teaching. We got to talk about the gospel, the good news of Jesus is coming to provide forgiveness of sin to all who believe. We got to proclaim consistently the gospel, the only story in history where the hero died for the villain. Each of us play an important role in the health of the church. Now, let me tell you this while I'm here. If you are nervous about the election, it's because you as a Christian haven't been doing your job to engage the lost. Because let me be clear, right? Let me be clear with something, right? We have the privilege to serve a sovereign God. And if we ought to be a healthy church, we must allow the Lord to lead us in everything. Meaning that we have to proclaim what is consistent with sound teaching. Listen, proclaiming what is consistent with sound teaching. Here it is. Watch this. Oh, Nikki Bennett, I'm about to get in trouble with this one, but I don't care. I drove myself here. I'm going to drive myself home. Listen to this. Proclaiming what is consistent with sound teaching is to promote, here it is, the kind of living that reflects sound teaching. Here it is. Proclaiming what is consistent with sound teaching is to promote the kind of living that reflects sound teaching. Let me tell you this, and we can't escape it either. See, we've been thinking that, right, I can proclaim Jesus, but I don't have to live Jesus. Let me tell you, that's an oxymoron. There's no way that you can experience the saving power of Jesus and your behavior not change. So you can't say, don't trip, God ain't through with me yet. Don't you be duped by Steve Harvey. Right? I was listening to an interview, Sister Tracy, a couple weeks ago. And this man, Steve Harvey, says, I'm an entry-level Christian. He says, I love Jesus, but I'll cuss you out. Right? So much so that this song by Toby Nwigi, I don't care what his name is, I can't pronounce it. He says, try Jesus. Don't try me, because I got them hands. I mean, bro got bars, and I can appreciate the bars, right? But for the blood ball, that should bring some sort of contention in our thoughts to think that it's okay for me to be a Christian but still be prideful on the fact that I got hands. There's no way that we can proclaim what is consistent with sound teaching and our lives not change. We ought to be tired, right, of saying we belong to Jesus, but our lives not showing it. It's funny. All on Facebook feed yesterday, Brother Anderson, all over Facebook, we seeing folks in costumes, right? See folks in costumes. And all I could do is laugh. Pastor Andrew, all I could do is laugh because I'm like, man, only if the church knew that they've been wearing costumes for years. Being somebody that they not, being hypocritical. We cannot continue to think that it's okay for us to proclaim what is consistent with sound teaching and not promote the kind of living that reflects it. We can't escape it, y'all. The Bible is a book that tells us how to live. It is the height of hypocrisy, y'all, to say that we believe its truth if we ignore how it tells us to live our lives. We don't always like it, y'all, but we always need to hear how God expects us to live. Paul, hearing this text simply, wants Titus, y'all, to fulfill the command of Jesus in Matthew 28, teaching them to observe all that I've commanded you. Man of God, woman of God, we ought to live by every word of God. Scripture says it this way: man must not live on bread alone, but on every word that comes from the mouth of God. All scripture is profitable, right? The church, let me tell you this, a church that fails to proclaim what is consistent with sound teaching is not obeying the Great Commission. The church that fails to proclaim what is consistent with sound teaching is a church that fails to disciple its people on sound living. A church that fails to proclaim what is consistent with sound teaching is not a church that obeys God. We must proclaim what is consistent with sound teaching. And here it is. When we're talking about proclaiming what's consistent with sound teaching, I'm not talking about a prosperity gospel. We aren't talking about some name it and claim it theology. We aren't talking about some teaching that makes you God, not a teaching that makes you a diva. We aren't talking about a teaching that promises that you will live your best life now. Well, what kind of teaching are we talking about? We're talking about a teaching that retells the single story that sweeps through all of Scripture. We must proclaim a teaching that summarizes and synthesizes the Bible's teaching as coherent whole. We must proclaim teaching that's a guide for the heart and a guard to your soul. We must, right, proclaim a teaching that is God's roadmap for Christian life and the life of the church. We must proclaim a teaching that promotes and nourishes holiness. We must proclaim a teaching that grounds and patterns our heart after love. We must proclaim a teaching that is the foundation of unity in the church. We must proclaim a teaching that gives fuel for the fire of worship. We must proclaim a teaching that equips and emboldens evangelism and discipleship. Here it is. We must proclaim a teaching that fills up our joy. What are you proclaiming? What are you proclaiming? We must proclaim teaching, y'all, that is consistent with sound doctrine. Each of us play a role in the health of the church. What am I saying? It has everything to do with you, what pastor. If I play a role, what is it? What is my role, pastor? You're giving me a lot of theory, but I need some application. I only got to verse 1. I still got 9 verses to go. Here it is. If I play a role, pastor, what's my role? What should I be doing? What's consistent with sound teaching? What's my role? Paul, in his text, if you looked, turned his attention to various groups within the congregation. He gave instruction for older men, older women, younger women, and young men, and bondservants. To all of these, y'all, Paul stressed the importance of building up the spiritual life of the believer as the best defense against error. Right? What's consistent with sound teaching? What's our role? Look at the text. He talks to us, y'all. Talk to the seasoned saints, the young saints, and the servants. First, he talks to the seasoned saints. Watch what he says. Older men ought to be sober-minded, dignified, self-controlled, sound in faith, in love, and in steadfastness. Older women, likewise, ought to be reverent in behavior, not slanderous or slaves to much wine. They ought to teach what is good. See, the aged men, older men, seasoned men ought to be sober, meaning they ought to be vigilant, grave, serious, right? Easy to respect, temperate, self-controlled, sound, healthy in their faith. Let me tell you this. If you are here and you are a man who are seasoned in the faith, let me tell you, you cannot afford to continually walk around unhealthy. You cannot continue to use as an excuse, don't trip, God ain't through with me yet. You cannot continue, even young men, as you grow in your faith, one day you will be an older man in the faith. Grow now so that when you reach that age, you have no excuses. He says, older men ought to be sober, grave, temperate, self-controlled, sound in the faith. See, spiritual health, y'all, let me tell you this. Spiritual health is more important than physical health. Spiritual health is more important than physical health, right? Y'all, physically, I'm a diabetic. But what I've been doing spiritually is trying to kill my sweet tooth. Some of us don't want to kill our sweet tooth because we care. Right, we care more about what's flattering to our tongue and not what's flattering to our heart. Right? Spiritual health is more important than physical health. Y'all, the love and patience of older men should be an example to all. Y'all, how difficult is it, y'all, for some senior saints to be patient with the younger generation? So impatient, not practicing patience because they jumping around and clapping and too loud. No. Right? Older men ought to be self-controlled, worthy of respect, sensible, sound in the faith, in love, and you must have endurance. But then he talks to aged, older, seasoned women. He says, aged, older, seasoned women ought to be reverent in their behavior, not gossips or drunkards. Let me tell you, older women have the wonderful opportunity of teaching the younger women in the church, both by precept and example. Y'all, it's possible, y'all, that Paul may have had in mind some of the widows who were supported by the church and expected them to minister to the members. Y'all, we've become a culture that has spent too much time arguing about what a woman can't do instead of empowering them to do what they can do. Like that's why, y'all, that's why young women ain't got no respect, because we won't unleash the older women on them. Moms, that's why your daughters don't respect you, because anytime an older woman tries to bring correction to them, you say, don't talk to my kid like that. No, if you don't whoop them, if you don't discipline them, let Adria, let Sister Georgette get them, right? We must allow, here it is, we must allow other folk to speak into the life of our kids, right? Y'all, they used to say back in the day, it take a village. But we don't want to be a village no more. We want things our own way. No. Each of us, y'all, have an important role in the health of the church. And if you don't allow your brother or your sister in the faith to own their role, then you are making them be disobedient to God. So he speaks to older women. He speaks to older men. But then Jaden Norwood, he speaks to the young whippersnappers. He begins to talk to the young saints. He says, verse 4, so that they may encourage the young women, right? Remember, before that, he said older women, right? He was talking to the older women, and he says, so that they may encourage the young women, here it is, to love their husbands, to love their children, to be self-controlled, pure workers at home, kind, and in submission to their husbands, so that God's word will not be slandered. See, here it is, right, the Bria family, right, hears that and says, right, well, what do I do with this? I ain't married, right? I ain't got no man. I ain't got no kids at home, right? What do I do with this? I would argue to my single brothers and sisters that you are married. You are married to the Father. And he is the one that you must submit to, right? He is your husband. You are the bride of Christ, and you must submit yourself to him. You still ought to be self-controlled. You still ought to live pure. You still should work at home and be kind and submit to your husband. Why? So that the word of God may not be slandered. Y'all, in the same way, he says, encourage the young men to be self-controlled in everything. Make yourself an example of good works with integrity and dignity in your teaching. Your message is to be found sound beyond reproach, so that any opponent will be ashamed because he doesn't have anything bad to say about us. See, Paul here. Paul speaks, y'all, first of young women, encouraging them to listen to older women and learn from them how to be godly wives and mothers. Y'all, let me tell you, our younger generation has closed their ears to the older generation, and we wondering why things are so jacked up. The younger generation is now closing their ears to the older generation. I told my son a little while ago that I ain't come out the womb like this. I bumped my head a couple of times, right? I know, right? My son thinks for some reason that I'm in my 70s or 80s, right? And I say, boy, you better hope that you look this good when you get this age, right? But here's the thing, young folks, older people didn't just come out the womb an older person. We done bumped our heads before. We done been through some stuff. Trust me, it may sound stupid to you today, but you'll thank us tomorrow. If we say don't go there, you probably shouldn't, right? If we say that's not the best use of your time, it's because we've wasted time on it before. I never forget, right? Had my little cousin, right? Y'all may be too young for this, but you had these things, Zach, called a hot plate. You don't know what a hot plate is, Zach? Google it, right? Y'all Google it. Look it right. Go to TikTok and search for hot plate and see what come up, right? Here's the thing. You said it's hot plate, and when it got hot, here it is. What color did it turn, Sister Georgette? It was red. It's like an orangey red color. You knew that if it was that color, don't touch it, right? So my grandmama used to tell my cousin, hey, don't touch that. Don't touch it. But for some reason, my cousin was mesmerized by the color. So he decided to touch it. Put his hand on it. He began to scream. So me being the loving cousin that I am, I sat in the back, and I laughed. Because I loved him, I had to laugh so that he can learn his lesson. You see? And grandmama told him, she said, listen, though you didn't understand why I told you not to do it, I knew what was best for you, so I told you not to do it. So now since you chose to do it, now you got to suffer the consequences for it. I mean, she got her butter, right? She put some butter on it. It was smelling like a biscuit, too. But she got her butter and put it on it, right? And she nursed him back to health. But she did so by helping him own his responsibility. What am I saying? Young folk, we make mistakes. We've made mistakes. We've bumped our head. What you see now, we didn't come out the womb this way. Yeah, you're going to burn your hand after we tell you not to touch it. But you might as well go on and get the stick of butter because we're going to love you through it. Right? But you have to learn to listen. Don't just close your ears. Right? Here it is. Right? We have, y'all, a description here of what God expects from a young Christian wife. He said she should be sober, taking a serious attitude toward marriage and the home. He said, no younger woman who does not want to be a serious wife and mother ought to marry. If you don't want to be a serious mother, if you don't want to be a serious wife, don't mess up nobody else, just don't get married. Let me tell you this. Home is not a playground. Home is not a playground. Y'all, love is vital to a happy home. So Paul reminds these women to love both their husbands and their children. Right? Let me tell you. The Christian wife, here it is, must have careful conduct, y'all, being discreet and chaste. The Christian wife must be a keeper of the home, right? She should be faithful at home and not put outside interests before her husband and her children. Why? Because the word, you shouldn't want the word of God to be blasphemed. Y'all, it's a tragedy, y'all, when a Christian home is a poor testament for Christ. Because of disobedient, careless people. Disobedient and careless husbands and wives whose values are confused. Putting the things of this world before the things of God. Y'all, the husband or the wife who neglects the home is worse than the unbeliever. Titus not only talks to the seasoned saints, older men, older women, young women. He also spends time talking to the young men. Paul writing to Titus, and since Titus was a young man himself, y'all, Paul used him as an example of what a young man ought to be like. He told him, he said, be a pattern of good works that all may follow. Be clean, be sincere, be serious, y'all. Those statements really summarize Paul's admonishment in verse 8. He reminds Titus that he must be careful in his speech lest the enemy find something to criticize. I know you've grown or you're growing and you think, young man, that you got a mind of your own. But let me tell you this. You must not get so distracted that with things going your way, that you forget that as a young Christian, you must be a pattern for good works. You must be a model. Let me tell you this, whether you got a title or not, somebody is watching you. Tyler, you're being watched. Michael Jr., you're being watched. Jordan, Jaden, Judah, Josiah, Zach, Titan, Trent, you're being watched. As a young Christian, right, you must be clean. You must be sincere, be serious, right? Don't allow the things of this world to distract you from being who God has called you to be. Each of us have an important role in the health of the church. But he didn't want to leave anybody out, so he talks then to older men, older women. Talks to young men and young women. But then he begins to talk to servants. Bond servants, he says, ought to be submissive to their own masters in everything. They ought to be well pleased, not argumentative, not pilfering, but showing all good faith, so that in everything they may adorn the doctrine of God our Savior. Some of your translations say, slaves, be submissive to your master. We ignore that, Sister Tracy. right? We don't want to hear it. Because the culture has misappropriated what it means to be a slave. See, in our culture today, this verse, y'all, is one that tends to upset us. Or even cause many of us to begin to question God. That we hear or see where slaves ought to be submissive to their masters and everything. And now we are thinking that God supports slavery. But let me tell you this, that couldn't be further from the truth. Not only because that wasn't what was being discussed here, but also, let me tell you this, God does not condone the type of treatment that many of our forefathers experienced. He doesn't condone that. Scripture condemns what we know to be slavery. Read Exodus 21 and Deuteronomy 23. You will begin to see that God does not condone American slavery or slavery anywhere. He does not condone that. And I know, right? I know that we still live in a time and a culture, right, where people think that minorities should be slaves. But I'm going to tell you, stop calling yourself a Christian if you embrace it. Right? We got folks saying, if you vote Democrat, you're not a Christian. No, if you think it's okay for you to be a slave owner, check your spiritual pulse because you might be dead. But we don't want to talk about that. But here it is. Paul, here as he talked to Titus, he wasn't talking about the slavery that this world defines, right? He was, Paul's principles for slave, he isn't referring to the contaminated idea or definition of slavery that this world provides for us, but really it applies here, bond servants to believers, here it is, at work. Talking about believers at work. See, here's the thing. Did you think that as an employee on your job that your Christendom didn't play a part in that? You actually thought, right, that you can turn off your walk with Christ when you walk into your job. Tell your boss like it is. And then pick up your Christian coat when you're going out. You dropping an F-bomb to your boss, being disrespectful, complaining about your job. But then when the day over, you say, God bless you. As employees at our jobs, y'all, we are admonished, y'all, to not argue, to not gripe and complain about what we don't want to do. He tells us in the text that as bond servants, right, we ought to be well-pleasing and not argumentative, not stealing, but showing all good faith so that in everything they may adorn the doctrine of God our Savior. Let me tell you, doctrine has very little to do with how much you know, but everything to do with how you live. Believer, do you know that how you behave at work affects the health of the church? Believer, do you know that how you behave at work affects your Christian life as well? Here's my question. Are you owning your responsibility as the church to be the church? But I want to be clear today. The state of the church has everything to do with you, young woman. The state of the church has everything to do with you, young man. The state and the condition and the health of the church has everything to do with you, older man. The state and the condition of the church has everything to do with you, older woman. The state and the condition of the church has everything to do with you, bond servant. Each of us have an important role in the health of the church. Well, what is that role? That role is to proclaim what is consistent with sound teaching, not only in what we say, but also in how we live. See, Paul knew, y'all, the character and behavior of believers would have an impact on those around him, either in a positive or a negative way. So he sought to encourage Titus to instruct them in behavior that would exalt the Lord and encourage sound teaching, encourage sound living, and to edify the church. Y'all, we all fit into at least one of these categories. And my prayer for you today, I pray that we will do all we can to possess and exhibit godly character so as to make a positive impact in our day. It has everything to do with you. And you must own your responsibility and proclaim all that has to do with sound teaching. Let's pray. Father, forgive us for abandoning our role as young men, young women, older women, and employees, bondservants. We've bought into this idea, Father, that it's okay for us to turn our backs and blame others for the pain that we experience. But today, my ask, Lord, is that you would be glorified in all we say and all we do. As your church strives to be a healthy church, don't remove your hand from us. But Lord, I pray that you would give us the strength to be all that you've called us to be. Father, we love you. We honor you. We adore you. We magnify you. And we make you big. Hear our prayer, O God, and make us more like you. In Jesus' name we pray. Amen. Thank you for joining us for worship today. And if the Lord is stirring your heart for you to respond today, whether you are virtual or here, fill out a virtual response card at fcbcstl.com/respond. We would love to pray with you, pray for you. We would love to have a conversation with you. Or even if you want to talk about what it looks like to have a relationship with Jesus, we would love to have that conversation with you. Again, fill out a virtual response card at fcbcstl.com/respond. If you want to give today to support the mission of Faith Community Bible Church, you can do so by going to fcbcstl.com/give. Again, fcbcstl.com/give to ensure that we can continue to make Christ known in the community by caring for the community. There's many places, many churches that you could have watched, many places, many churches to where you could have sat in on today. But we're thankful today that you chose Faith Community as your place of worship. And as we leave today, know this, that the state of the church has everything to do with you. And you must own your responsibility to not only proclaim with your mouth, but live in your heart. And your behavior was consistent with sound teaching. God bless you, and God keep you, is our prayer. You're dismissed. Have a great day.
God is great.